Verse number 31. Are you with me? Are you with me? Here it is. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Yeah. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, we pray. You're already here. Just go ahead and have your way in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah. You all already know the subject. You just finished shouting about it just a few minutes ago. Look at somebody said, I sure did. I sure did. I knew the subject. I did. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Universally, it is complained that God, universally, it is complained. People complain about how God is unjust. People complain about how unjust God is. And usually the person making the complaint believes that God is unjust toward them personally. Personally. Is it an accurate statement that God is unjust? And if so, can I ask the question, why is God unjust? Is it because God does not care, or because God takes, or God rather, lacks sufficient strength or ability to do all that must be done? Listen, Isaiah affirms that in as much as God is not only the creator, but also the sustainer of all things, including the heavens, the nations, and the individual people, how can people consider that it is God who has forsaken them? How can people, look at your neighbor, say, how can you do that? How can people who are by nature weak and sinful claim that the righteous, benevolent, all-knowing, all-powerful God is unjust? Listen, if you will. It is not God who has forsaken us. Mm-mm. No, look at somebody say, not on a good day. Nope. God has not forsaken us, but we have forsaken God. Yet those who wait on the Lord in faithful assurance that God can and will keep God's promises will find the strength and support to perform the task of life all the way till the end of life. First of all, let me consider this, or let us consider this. God will do it God's way. I don't care how much energy and effort you put into your situation. I came by here to tell you that God is going to do it God's way. He's not going to do it your way. And maybe the problem that so many people have is they are so busy trying to do things their way instead of doing it God's way.
Listen, the prophet begins addressing a series of questions to the people in verse number 27. Why will you say, O Jacob, and then asserts, O Israel? The uncompleted action tense of the verb in Hebrew, it indicates, my beloved, that they have said it in the past. They are saying it in the present, and that they will say it in the future. Why doesn't God take action right here, right now in this situation? Is a continual complaint that we will see has no just grounds. They are complaining about why God won't do it. And I know Israel, it's not in the boat by themselves. There's some of us in here who also exclaim with all energy and power, asking the question, where is God and why won't God move right now? The two names of the patriarchs are both given. Jacob means deceiver. Israel means the God ruled one, and is the name God gave Jacob after his wrestling experience with God when he was finally saved. The meaning is that both the lost and the saved say the same thing about God. Stop talking about people who are not saved, because saved people sometimes act just like unsaved people. Here we are, saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost, asking the question, why doesn't God act? Why doesn't God move? Why doesn't God do something? I know I'm not preaching to the choir, because all of us have at least once said or asked the question, where is God? As much as I go to church and serve in ministry, where is God? As many times as I go to Bible study, where is God? As many times as I pray on a consistent, regular basis, where is God? Here's the question. Why doesn't God act? Is it because God is unwilling, or because God is incapable? Whew. The thoughts of people continue, or humanity rather, in verse 27 continue with, my way is hidden from the Lord. The term way is the common figure for course, pattern, manner, or direction of life. My way refers to their self-centered focus on life. Most people are self-centered, only thinking about themselves. They believe that the world should revolve around them, and since it obviously isn't, there must be something wrong. They complain about it to God, and nothing seems to happen. So obviously God is not seeing them or their situation for what it is. They are trying to get God to see things from their perspective, and God is trying to get them to see things from God's perspective. They want God to do things their way when God wants them to do things God's way. Am I on somebody's street today? Their complaint continues in verse 27c, and the justice due me escapes the notice of my God. Here it is. The idea is that their just cause is forgotten, neglected, or dismissed by the judge. It is a universal complaint which arises in times of difficulty and adversity. It is the notion that since I am correct, vindication of my problem would come about if God brought me real justice. The person is skeptical and hopeless, believing God is not fulfilling God's promises to him or her. Thus, in reality, they are saying, in essence, that God is unjust. The form of unbelief is familiar to the personal experience of all of us, and God acknowledging lost people of all ages. It comes when one doubts God's goodness and or God's ability to fulfill God's promises. It comes from a pride that says we know more what God should do than God does. The accusation is that God is either A, does not know God's job as judge, B, God cannot do the job, C, God is too tired for the job, D, God is not aware of my situation, or E, that God simply does not care. Moses said in Genesis 18 and 25, C, shall not the judge of all the earth do right? Did you hear that? God will not do anything that is unfair. God is not going to do anything that is untrue. God is not going to do anything that is inappropriate by taking the entire situation into consideration. Listen to this. A creator who knows the name of all the stars, verse number 26, certainly knows the problems of his people. A creator who made the constellation certainly has the capacity to deal with our concerns. And so the prophet responds to the people. Centered observations begins in verse number 28. Here it is. It's in the text. He says, do you not know? Do you not know? Do you not know? He says, have you not heard? Oh my goodness. Isaiah's response is a double question which sets forth the foolishness of such hopeless thoughts or attitudes. God has been, God is, and God will be readily available for those who will listen and learn. God then affirms who God is. He is the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not become weary or tired. Can I just say that one more time to somebody who thinks God fell asleep on you? I came by here to tell you that God never becomes weary and God doesn't get tired. God does not get tired, neither does he become tired like a person who lacks nourishment, nor does God become weary like a person who is exhausted by overexertion. God created the limits and bounds. Limits and bounds did not define God, and they do not hold God. I came to tell you that your limitations in life, they do not hinder God. We all got limitations, but I came by to tell somebody, just because you have limitations doesn't mean that God has limitations. God can see everything that you're going through, and God is not limited. When God is good and ready, he's going to show up in your life and change your situation. Can I say this to somebody? Can I say it? Nothing is beyond the range of God's vision or the domain of God's power. Nothing. Look at somebody, tell them nothing. Nothing. The God that created all is the same God. Ooh, I love that. He's the same God. He's the same God, never changing and still possessing and manifesting the power which God displayed in creation. Let me say it this way. God's delay never means a lack of awareness or a lack of ability. Just because God hadn't shown up in your life yet doesn't mean that God is not aware and that God is not able to do something about it. God is the God of eternity, and Yahweh is the eternal God. God has no beginning, and God has no ending. Did you hear what I said? God has no beginning, and God has no ending. God is everlasting. Even if God, as God, exists beyond one day after everlasting, is still the same. It simply means that God is everlasting, and if God is everlasting, God can do anything that God wants to do. Watch this. When God feels like doing it, God is eternal. God's understanding is enigmatic. God's understanding, it is profound. It is not easily understood. It is beyond our ability to judge. We don't have a right to judge a God who knows everything, a God who can do everything and anything in your life. Just because he didn't show up yesterday and he didn't show up this morning, it doesn't mean that God doesn't have the ability to change it. It just simply means that when God gets ready to do it, that God is going to do it. And if I could pause here for a second and determine that I'm so glad when I wanted something right up front in the present that God didn't give it to me. God said, you need to wait on it for a little while. You need to let it marinate. And when God did that, I'm so glad because it blessed my life. I wonder if there's anybody here now who can testify that you are so glad that you didn't get it when you thought you should have got it. You're so glad you didn't get the job when you thought you should have got the job. You're so glad you didn't get the check when you thought you should have received the check. You're so glad that you didn't marry that person beforehand. You were so glad because there's some things that God needs to allow to marinate in your life before God throws it at you. Because if we're not careful, what God gives us, we can destroy it in just a matter of seconds. We ought to be glad about it. Look at somebody, say, I'm glad about it. Listen. Paul said in Romans, I want to slap you with some New Testament drama. Paul says declares in Romans 11, 33 through 36, the understanding or the wisdom that characterizes God's ways, which are the basis for his actions, are such that men or women cannot fathom or comprehend them. Man or woman cannot search out God's understanding. The mind of God cannot grasp the mind of humanity cannot grasp the mind of God. We must simply trust God. Did you hear what I said? You may not understand it, but I need you to trust it. You may not be able to see what God is doing, but I need you to trust it. You don't know how God is going to bring you through, but I need you to trust it. You've been dealing with an illness for some time. I just need you to trust God. You've been dealing with some crazy people on your job. I need you to trust God. You've been dealing with some craziness in your house. I need you to trust God. You've been dealing with crazy people in your neighborhood. I just need you to trust God. Look at somebody, say, trust God. Trust it. Let me put it this way, if I can. God's ways are right, even though they do not seem to favor us. Whew. God's ways are right, even though we may not be able to comprehend them fully. We must trust that God's ways are right and that justice is occurring or will occur both corporately and individually. At the end of the day, I came by here to tell somebody that God's justice is going to prevail in your life. Verse 29, I'm in the text. Verse 29, it tells the real truth. He gives strength. I like it right there. Somebody who's weak and weary right now, I need you to hear this real quick. Verse 29, it tells us, he gives strength to the weary, and to him who lacks might, he increases their power. Far from being weary himself, God is the one who gives strength to those who are weary. God is not only strong for God's self, but God is the giver of strength to others. Those who may be exhausted through their suffering and trials are the weary ones, and they receive strength from God. Not only does God give, but God gives abundantly. Oof, I wish I had somebody in here who could testify that when God gave to you, God gave to you abundantly. You only asked for something minimal, but God opened up a major door in your life. You only asked for one thing, but God gave you a few more things than you asked for, because God gives abundantly. Look at somebody, say, he gives abundantly. Yeah, we know that he who gives such strength and ability to others must be strong and able himself. Well, a South American company, they purchased a fine printing press from a firm in the United States. After it had been shipped and completely assembled, the workmen could not get it to operate properly. Bought this machine and it will not work. The most knowledgeable, the most intelligent person there in the office tried to adjust it, but to no avail. And so the company finally, after trying to work with it and make it work, couldn't get it done. They sent a wire to the manufacturer asking for a representative to come and fix it. Look at somebody, say, fix it, fix it, fix it. Sensing the urgency of the request, the U.S. firm sent the designer of the press. He didn't send somebody from the U.S. that could fix it or work on it. They sent the designer. And when he arrived on the scene, the company officials were skeptical because he was a young man. And so after discussing the situation, they sent a message to the manufacturer. They said, your man that you sent is too young. Whew. They said, you need to send us somebody who's more experienced. Well, a reply, a few moments of reply came back, and it said, let me help you. He made the machine. Let him fix it. Okay, somebody is going, you're going to get an opportunity to shout when you get in your car and pick this one up. We are in a similar situation. Every area of life seems to be in chaos. People don't know how to pull everything together. Binding habits, enslaving sins, and nagging guilt leaves them confused. Man-made plans and solutions, they offer us little hope. It is described for your situation, rather. If this describes the situation, I came by to tell you there is an answer. For Paul declares in Colossians chapter 1, 13 and 18, you will find forgiveness, cleansing, peace, and order when Jesus, who has made you, is invited to come in and take control of your life. The Creator is also your Savior. And so can I say to somebody today, if you would just let me give some more prophecy in this house, let me tell you that the Lord is going to fix it. So you ought to let him fix it. Fix it. Let him fix it. Look at somebody, say, let him fix it. To get your life on the right track, you've got to let the Creator take control. Well, not only does God do it God's way, but finally, those with faith will find their way. I came by to tell you, you're going to find your way because you've got faith in God. Let me say it one more time. You are going to find your way because you have faith in God. Listen to the text. Listen to verse number 30. It says, even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. Listen, God does not become weary. Okay, let me say that one more time because somebody didn't get it. God doesn't become weary. People become weary. Okay, you missed it. God doesn't get weary. We get weary. Furthermore, what they have accused God of is the condition of even the strongest and most vigorous. For the youth intended here are the choicest, those fit for athletics or an athletic contest or military service. Man, can I just ask somebody in here who served in the military and you retired and they want you to go back on the battlefield? They want you to get in another helicopter at your age now? You who used to jump out of them at ease when you were young, and they tell you now, we got a mission. We calling you back. We need you to put on the backpack and the parachute. And you need to jump out now, at your age now. Okay, y'all, you missed it. I'm telling you, you're going to get a call. Strap up. Yeah, but you know, I've already served 35 years. So, strap up. Get on, get on, as Medea would say, get on the helicopter, get on it, and jump. No, somebody said, that's for a young soldier. Oh, y'all missed it. That's for a young soldier. Here it says, even the young soldier who has strength and ability to do the job gets tired. Whew. They can become exhausted and they stumble. Let me just say this. Our bragging in our own strength, be it physically, mental, or spiritual, has no foundation. Even at best, people apart from God are doomed to failure and defeat. Many believers become exhausted by the frantic activity of modern living. Listen, we plan, we work, and we schedule, hurrying here and there, unaware that we are being fashioned. Listen to this. We're being designed by our own hectic lifestyles. Whew. Because of the madness that we go through every day, we design our lifestyle based on the drama and the mess we go through. Could it be that we have never learned the discipline of slowing down? Look at somebody say, you got to slow down sometimes. Can I tell you this story real quick? There was a first grader wondered why her father brought home a briefcase full of work every evening. She wanted to know. And so her mother explained. She said, Daddy has so much to do that he can't finish all of his work in the office. Well, then, asked the little girl innocently, she said, why don't they put Daddy in a slower group? You didn't get it. That's okay. You're going to pick it up in just a second. Verse 31, it tells us how to gain God's strength and live God's way. Yet those who wait for the Lord will renew their strength. Yet, on the other hand, the antithesis for what just went before, it is an entirely different story. What may happen to strong young men does not happen to those who wait on the Lord. Oh, man. Yeah. To wait or expect implies faith and patience. Did you hear what I said? If you're going to wait, you've got to learn how to have faith and you've got to have some patience. You can't be a believer unless you've got some faith and you've got some patience. And you've got to use it in your life. We are not simply to wait. We are to wait on God. We ought to put God, our trust in God. We ought to put our trust in the Lord, not in creed, not in ritual, not in convention or a leader. We got to put our trust in God. The people described are those who show their confidence in God's ability and willingness, to execute his promises by patiently awaiting their fulfillment. The just shall live by faith. They have developed dependence on God and a willingness to allow God to lead or act first. Well, as a result of those who wait upon the Lord, is they will gain a new strength. New strength, or more accurately, the Hebrew word halaf. That's that word for renew. And that word means they shall exchange strength. That simply means they change strength with God. God changes his strength with us. God changes his strength with them. So when you look at the text, we see that God is in the business of changing strength. What capacity is possessed by those who wait on the Lord and will exchange for strength that is real indeed? Let me just move on down here. I want to give you just three quick things. I'm not even going to expound on it. Here it comes. God gives three magnificent promises. Here it is. Promise number one, God says they will mount up with wings as eagles. When does the eagle show its greatest strength? When it pulls upward against the force of gravity. It does this by long, powerful strokes. And as the eagle pulls loose from gravity to mount up high into the sky so that the people of God will mount up. The second promise is they will run and not get tired. There are crisis times, emergencies when we simply cannot quit. I tell somebody right now, don't you quit. When our pace quickens to a run, we work all day and minister to loved ones each night, day after day. Doctors tell us that the emergency hours of life release in our body strength that we'll never know, or strength rather, we never knew we had. Our glands go to work and put extra power into the bloodstream, and we are able to do amazing things. Look at somebody say, I'm going to do an amazing thing. Here it is. Thirdly and finally, very quickly, it says they will walk and not faint. This problem refers to our daily routine of normal life. Those that wait on the Lord will keep on keeping on and not quit when they face weariness and depression. These are the people who, when they encounter difficulty, experiences in life, they don't turn to drinking, they don't turn to drugs, they don't turn to illicit sex, they don't turn to distracting activities. They find the inner strength to keep on keeping on the duties of life and their service to the Lord. Truthfully, I think it more difficult to keep on walking than to fly. When we turn to the Lord in those crisis times and we find his power to soar above our problems, there is a special excitement. But what about our daily routine of life? Day after day, life comes to us, but God has promised to give us the strength we need every day so that we can walk and not faint. God promises us strength every day. Every day he does. If you wait, he says, on me, I will help you in the humdrum of life, in the weariness of sameness, in your daily routine of life. The question is, you begin to wait on God, or will you rather wait on God every day? Well, let me just move on and get to the close here. I just want to just give you this closing illustration, and then we're going to watch the Super Bowl. Here it is. Yeah, I've got to learn how to wait on God. I got to learn how to be patient because God is on God's way. There were two frogs. They fell in a tub of cream. Two frogs did. One looked at the high sides of the tub, which were too difficult to crawl over, and said, it is hopeless. That's what the frog said. Frog looked up, two of them down in a tub of cream. They were in cream, and one frog looked up, said, it's hopeless. It's hopeless. So he resigned himself to death. He relaxed, and he sank to the bottom, and he died. Well, the other one determined to keep swimming. He was determined to keep swimming as long as he could, that something might happen. Let me just tell somebody in here, you got to keep on swimming even when you don't see what God is doing. He just kept on swimming. He did. It said here that this other frog kept kicking and he kept churning. He didn't do like his frog buddy. His frog buddy said, nope, I see what I'm looking at, and it's over. I'm going to die, so let me just go ahead and give up. Look at somebody, say, don't ever give up. Yeah. But his friend, froggy number two, he just kept on kicking and he kept on churning. And finally, he found himself on a solid platform of butter, and he jumped out to safety. What am I telling you? I'm saying that when you're waiting on God and you're going through some madness and drama in your life, you've got to learn how to keep on kicking and churning. You missed what I said. You got to keep on. You got to keep going. Look at somebody say, you've got to keep going. You've got to learn how to wait on God. But while you're waiting on God, you don't sit still and do absolutely nothing. You have to learn how to keep on kicking and churning. That just simply means you've got to keep on working. You've got to keep going. Look at somebody, say, you've got to keep going. Yeah, you got to keep going. And one of the things I like about the text is that God is suggesting to here to the Israelites that you've got to keep on going. Yep, I know that you've had some hard times and some difficulty, and as you are on your way to find the place that I'm going to set you in, you're going to have some trials and some difficulties, but I came by to tell you that I'm going to exchange my strength for your strength. That just means that you might be going through, and God in your going through is going to make a way for you somehow. Well, can I talk to somebody in here right now? You find yourself just like the people in the text. You find yourself in trouble and you can't seem to find your way through. I came by here to tell you that you've got to lift up your head. Look at somebody, say, you've got to lift up your head. I came by to tell you that God is in the business of blessing his people. Look at your neighbor, say, the Lord is going to bless you. He's going to bless you. Look at a few more people around you, say, he's going to bless you. Yes, he is. For the Lord didn't bring you here this far to leave you by yourself. Look at somebody, say, he's not going to leave you. He's not going to leave you. And so as long as I still got breath in my body, I'm going to keep on lifting up the name of Jesus. As long as I still I've got my energy, I'm going to lift him up even in my waiting. That's why you've got to learn how to wait. Look at somebody, say, learn how to wait. You've got to learn how to wait. For my Bible says, it does, it says that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. It just simply means that they that wait on God, it means that God's going to show up and God is going to take out your weakness and fill your weakness with his strength so that you've got the power and the ability to keep holding on. I'm ready to preach this thing now. Look at somebody, say, preach, pastor. I'm going to preach. Thank you so kindly for asking me to do that. I came by here to tell a few of y'all, don't know who I'm talking to. He said, you've got to learn how to wait. Look at somebody, say, just wait, just wait, just wait, just wait, just wait. Let me tell you this story. I told this story earlier. I was talking about how when I grew up, I told you, I grew up with a father who was a military man. He was a military man. And those of you who have military men in the house, you know, they can be tough sometimes. And my dad, he was in the Navy. A military man, whether you're in the Navy, whether you're in the Army, whether you're in the Air Force or the Marines, you got some toughness built on the inside. And so, you know, my daddy, he was tough. Look at somebody, say, tough. He was tough. I mean, he was sure enough tough. Man, if you had an opportunity to know my daddy and you saw him, you would say, Charles Tillett did that? Yes, he did. If you saw him, yeah, he was around today, you would look at him and say, oh, that mild-mannered man, he would never put his hands on anybody. Well, I beg to differ. That was different. Now, mama, on the other hand, she was the one who had the soft voice, the one, as I shared earlier, that when we went out and we were cutting up, mama was the one that said, I'm going to get you when we get home. You keep on playing, I'm going to get you. And then by the time we got home, let me help somebody, mama didn't do anything, because I don't really believe mom wanted to put the belt on us anyhow. Well, let me tell you about Charles F. Tillett Sr. He was cut from a different cloth. If we were out, you know, I said earlier, at the Navy Exchange or the commissary, I don't know what they call them today. The Navy Exchange was the place where you go and you buy your clothes. That's where you got your clothes, you know. And then the commissary is where you got the groceries, you know. That was back in the day when your parents could go shopping and they could leave you in the car and nobody said nothing about it. The police didn't say a word. They could leave you in the car. car and they would tell you, stay in the car, behave yourself, don't get out, and don't you do nothing. Well, we used to get in the car, might as well go ahead and tell all on myself. We would get inside the car, and my older brother, he would get in the driver's seat. I would climb up and get in the passenger seat, and then he would put his foot on the brake when a car was coming by because the parking lot was crowded, you know, and we just got a kick out of people stopping, waiting for us to back out so they could park. And so he put his foot on the brake. Brake light came on. People thought we were getting ready to back up, but we wasn't going nowhere. And we just cackled and laughed, and we had a good time at it. But one of the things I found out, I discovered that my father was one who noticed what we were doing. Yep, he came to the car. He said, I want to know, what are you doing? And we said, nothing. You know how it is. Kids do the same thing today. What you doing? Nothing. Nothing. Yep. Yep. Okay. All right. Y'all not doing nothing. Okay. Well, don't have a problem. But Daddy said, he said, just wait till we get home. I'm trying to help somebody. He said, just wait. Yeah. Y'all not there yet? Just wait. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because he had what he had. He had to get it in the car, and he had to get us home. Now, some of you understand that I had parents, and some of you had parents the same way. I'm really trying to get to a point, but I'm getting good at getting real good in this illustration here. You had parents like my father who said that if you act a fool in public, I'ma wear you out in public. Anybody ever had that happen before? Yep. Well, let me say, this particular situation wasn't like that. It was at night, and Dad came out. He got in the car, and we drove home. We got to the house. We did. And then he went inside of the house, and then, you know, we tried, you know how it is. We tried to get out of it. You know, we tried to get ourselves changed and get ready for bed. Have you ever went to bed before you were supposed to go to bed because you didn't want to get in trouble? You trying to climb into bed and it's 6 o'clock. You know you don't go to bed till about 9 o'clock at night, and here we are trying to get ourselves together. But if you had a father like my father, he didn't care if you got in the bed. He had a way. And let me just help somebody. I'm gonna help you. My father had a way. He did. He had a way. He had a way. He had a way. He had a really nice way. He did. He had a way. He said, they can go to bed if they want to, but I owe you something. You've been waiting for this, and let me go ahead and give it to you. And then my father, he was very generous. It was three of us. It was three of us, and all of us got it. I figured by the time my father got done with my older brother, he would be too tired to deal with me. But my older brother was the warm-up, and he got me like he didn't touch my older brother. And then the baby brother, he was the kind, you know, you saw him all big and brawny. Looked like he about 6'3", 300 pounds. He was the one that when Daddy came in to get him next, he fell all out on the ground screaming and crying before he was touched. What I'm trying to say to somebody in here is this. My father, yeah, he told us in the parking lot of the commissary, he said, just wait. And then when we got home, he answered what he said he was going to. Can I help somebody in here? You have a father, and your father is telling you, just wait. He's telling you, just wait, because he's got something bigger ahead for you. And you can't sit around all upset and bent out of shape. You can't. I'm trying to help you now. Here it is. I'm bringing it to a close. I need a few people in here who can testify that your father says to you, your heavenly father, he says, I've got something for you. Yep. You just have to learn how to wait. Gotta wait. Look at a few people around you. Say, you got to wait. Because I promise you. I'm telling you. I promise you. I double promise you. I'm telling you. If my earthly father keeps his promises, my father in heaven is going to keep his promises. I'm trying to help somebody. If my earthly father is true to his word, I came to tell you that my father in heaven is true to his word. And if God said he gonna do it, I need you to strap yourself up. I need you to raise yourself up. I need you to put your shoulders back. I need you to put your head up. I need you to know and understand that the same God who woke you up this morning, he's the same God. He's the same God that created the foundations of this world. He's the same God. The same God that knows your coming in and your going out. The same God who put everything in order. The same God that'll bless you right now in this sanctuary. I need somebody look at your neighbor and say, Pastor, preach. Pastor, preach. I'm so glad you asked me to. Can I help you today? You've got a God that sticks to his promises. If you're sick, the Lord, he's going to heal your body. If you're broke, the Lord will put some money in your pocket. Yes, he will. If you're lonely, yeah, the Lord will give you a companion. Yes, he will. I know he'll do it for you. If you don't have a place to live, God will give you a roof over your head. No money in the bank. I know he will. He'll put money in your pocket. You'll get a check in the mail. Let me just ask a question. I need some confirmation. Is there anybody here who's ever got a check in the mail? You didn't know it was coming. You didn't even expect it. It was from the insurance company. And the insurance company said this. On the check it said that you overpaid. And God sent a little bit back. Let me help you in that situation. That simply means that God made an investment and he put some money to the side. You thought it was an extra payment, but God understood that you were going to need the money in a few days, and he put it to the side. And then you opened the mailbox and you pulled out the check and you said, thank you, Jesus. I just need to know, is there anybody here who opened up the mailbox and there was a check and it had your name on it? Let me just see if I can get you right now to give God some praise for the check in the mailbox. Let me help you. I'm still there. I'm getting ready to sit down. I got to go. But I know I got a God who is filled with promises. You know your credit ain't no good. Look at somebody, say no good, no good. And you went down and you applied and you were sitting there just like some of us did. You were praying. You were saying, oh Lord, I know they gonna see that. Oh, I hope that's still not on there. I didn't pay that bill a couple years ago. It went to collection and I hope it's not on there anymore. And you were sitting there and you were twiddling your fingers trying to figure out whether or not you were gonna get the loan. But then, yeah, they came back in and they said approved. They sat the paper down, approved. And then you looked at them just like this. You said, yeah, I knew I wasn't going to have no problems. I knew I was going to get it. That ain't true, because a few moments ago, you were scared to death. You were shaking in your boots. You didn't know that God was going to make a way out of no way. I came here to tell somebody, you got to learn how to wait. Look at somebody, say, just wait. Just wait. I'm trying to help you. Hey, and if you're waiting for your miracles, you've got to learn how to wait. Oh, I feel my help coming. I got to go. But you know how it is. When you feel the presence of God in the atmosphere, you can't help but open your mouth and give God praise. I need about 10 people in here. 10 of y'all. Can I get 10? Can I get 10? I need 10. If you would just open your mouth and give God praise. You didn't know, you didn't know, you didn't know. You were practicing, yeah, you were practicing some stuff that you shouldn't have been practicing. And you went down to see the doctor. I know I got a witness in here. And you were hoping that the doctor test would come back negative. Yep, you waited and you were afraid and you were scared to death. But then the doctor came in and said negative, and you don't even know why it was negative. All the stuff you were doing, you don't know why, but you can give God praise in your new sanctified spirit and say, thank you, God, that I no longer I feel like preaching. Can I get a little closer to you? I came to tell somebody, you've got to learn how to wait. Look at your neighbor, say, wait. You've got to wait. Fist bump somebody, say, wait. I'm going to wait. I don't care how bad it is, I'm going to wait. I don't care how devastating it is, I'm going to wait. I don't care how challenging it is, I'm going to wait. Look at somebody, say, I'm going to wait. I'm going to wait. I'm going to wait. You might as well keep on waiting. You've been waiting a little while. A few more days ain't going to hurt. Just keep on waiting. Because if you wait, the Lord will give you new strength. If you wait, the Lord will open up a door. If you wait, I'm trying to sit down, but I feel the presence of God in this place. Can I prophesy one more time? Can I tell somebody in this section, just wait on God? Just wait. Look at somebody, say, wait, wait. All you gotta do is wait. It's on the way. I'm gonna talk to about 20 more y'all, and I'm getting out of here. Look at somebody, say, wait. You got to wait. I got to go. You got to wait. I gotta get out of here. I got to go. If I don't get out of here, I'm not gonna stop preaching. I got to go. Look at somebody, say, wait. Wait, 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 wait for what? Wait for my opening. Wait for my blessing. Wait for my breakthrough. Wait for, wait for, wait for. And then I'ma get my praise while I'm waiting. I need some people in here. You ready to open up your mouth and give God some praise? I've got to go. But before I go, I need about 15 people. Sanctuary, give him praise with your whole heart, give him praise with all of your energy, give him praise with the power of God, give him praise. I need some folk to open up your mouth and give God some praise. Praise God in the sanctuary, praise God in the atmosphere, lift him up. Look at somebody, say, just wait, just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Look at somebody, say, just wait. Tell them I'm double dutching. I'm waiting to jump in. Tell somebody, I'm just waiting. I'm waiting. Look at your neighbor, say, just wait. Come on, everybody, stand with me. Come on.